Dear friends and followers, welcome back to my channel. Today's video is an important topic, especially when it comes to cold weather operation. Why do airplanes have to be de-iced? So let's get started.
Tower 1383, runway 27, clear to take off. United 1538, number 3271.
If you're a plane spotter or a pilot or just an aviation enthusiast, build your own website with Squarespace at www.squarespace.com/CaptainJoe. They're today's sponsor of this video. Now, I'm sure many of you have experienced this before. You get onto your flight home during Christmas time, maybe, you get pushed back, you taxi near the active runway, and then the captain announces,
Ladies and gentlemen, a very good morning, Captain. We are on de-icing treatment.
Sounds familiar? A minimum of 15 minutes delay guaranteed. So you might ask, why is it so important to remove the snow and ice from airplanes? The critical surfaces on an airplane, such as the wings and control surfaces like the slats and flaps and ailerons, horizontal and vertical stabilizers, have to be free of any contamination. Because even minor levels of contamination will have a negative impact on aerodynamic performance. Frost, ice, or snow accumulation with a roughness of equivalent to a medium sandpaper can reduce the lift by much as 30% and increase drag as much as 40%. Therefore, the changes in lift and drag significantly increase the stall speed and lower the angle of attack, reduce controllability, and result in a major impact on the airplane's flight characteristics. To make matters worse, most airplanes have stall speed warnings which come active at a preset speed or angle of attack, meaning in case of ice on the wings, the crew might not even receive a stall warning at all. So any kind of contamination of the critical surface needs to be thoroughly looked at during the outside check, and there are many different types of icing which can be found on the airplanes. For example, overnight frost, very similar to what you remove off of your car for their freezing night. Clear ice, which can be difficult to detect as it is transparent and it is a result of frozen water patches or snow which has melted and froze up again. Rime ice is mostly experienced during climb and approach phases. Mixed ice, seen when planes are parked outside for longer periods where various ice forms freeze and then slightly melt and freeze up again. So how would you deal with ice that has accumulated on your wings before the flight? Now, the outside check is absolutely mandatory as contamination could have damaged sensitive instruments like the pitot tubes, the static ports, and angle of attack instruments. You might even have to ask for mobile stairs to get a closer look of the upper wing surface. So once you've completed your outside check and have notified the pilot flying about the contaminated wings, etc., you want to contact your ground operator to sign you up for airplane de-icing. You'll then be put on a waiting list and start up your engines accordingly. Now, during taxi, it is standard procedure to extend your flaps and perform a flight control check, but all standard procedures and checklists shall be on hold until the de-icing of the airplane is completed. So no flight control inputs or flap extensions shall be made, as the contamination of snow and ice could potentially damage the flight controls. Imagine your windscreen wipers frozen to the windshield of your car, and as soon as you flip the switch, the chance of breaking your wipers is pretty high. So prior reaching the de-icing pad, you perform the de-icing, anti-icing procedure on ground checklist. Now, as you see here, the checklist demands engine bleed 1 and 2 off, such as the APU bleed off. Why is that so? Now, the engine bleed system generated by the engine compressor stage partly provides bleed air for the air conditioning system, so in case some of the de-icing fluid, which is primarily a propylene glycol-based fluid, which is fairly toxic, could get sucked into the engine intake and end up in the passenger cabin. Therefore, you turn off the engine and APU bleed air to reduce the chance of that happening. Also, the ditching push button comes to on, which has the function that all exterior inlet and outlet valves get closed in case the plane ditches on water, so to say, sealing the aircraft. Now, for instance, the big outflow valve at the rear part of the fuselage closes because you don't want de-icing fluids running into the airplane. Once the checklist is completed, the airplane is ready for spraying operation. You then notify the de-icing crew via radio communication which areas of the plane you want to get de-iced, and then they get started.
81, brakes are set, we are ready.
681, that's been good morning. We copy that. It's going to be wings and tail type 1. We begin the icing right now.
The fluid sprayed onto the wing is also known as a freezing point depressant. These fluids are most effective when the fluid is thermally heated and sprayed onto the wing with a high pressure. Now, these fluids can come in various mixtures and are categorized in fluid types which have different effects once they are applied to the airplane. Type 1 is primarily used as a de-icing agent to remove ice, frost or snow from the aircraft surfaces and is applied hot and is usually dyed orange. Type 2 is often applied in a two-step process. The first application is a heated de-icing fluid to remove most of the contamination. And the second step is the same fluid, but non-heated, and it acts as an anti-icing agent. Then there's type 3 fluid, which is a compromise out of type 1 and 2, which is generally applied to turboprop aircrafts as they have a lower liftoff speed than jet-propelled airplanes. And I'm sure many of you have seen type 4 fluids as they have this green jelly look-alike texture. Type 4 is very often used in collaboration with either type 1 and 2 fluids, which remove the contamination, and then a green layer of anti-icing type 4 fluid is applied to significantly increase the holdover time. Type 2, 3 and 4 fluids all have anti-icing properties such that when applied to a clean surface, they are designed to protect the aircraft from ice accumulation for a predicted length of time, the so-called holdover time. The ground crew will inform you about the type and mixture they have used and when the spraying operation started. You then open up the holdover timetable to check how long the application will hold over until your takeoff. Let's quickly take a look at the holdover timetable. The METAR indicates light snow showers. The reported temperature is -4 degrees. Reading down from the conditions and across from temperature, you derive a holdover time for undiluted type 4 fluid of 30 to 55 minutes. So once the spraying operation is completed, you perform the upon completion of spraying operation checklist. You then make sure that all the ground equipment is removed with confirmation of the ground crew, and then resume the normal operation and perform the checklist leading up to the takeoff roll, such as flight control checks and flap settings. Please take my advice. Do not underestimate even minor ice patches on your airplane's critical surfaces. Very often, it's difficult to determine if there is ice or not, especially in low light conditions. Also, keep in mind airplanes are built out of alloy and composite materials which react differently to ice. So sometimes one surface seems clean, but the other might be contaminated. So be wise and get rid of your ice. Please be aware, this is just a basic explanation of the de-icing and anti-icing operation. There is so much more to learn, trust me. So next week, we'll talk about how airplanes deal with ice within flight. Thank you very much for your time. Please perform a touch and go at my Instagram account, De-ice planes only, please. And don't forget to hit the subscribe button plus the notification bell so you won't miss out upcoming videos. All the best, see you next week. Your Captain Joe. I want to give out a big shout out to Squarespace for supporting this video. I recently started to do speaking appearances at events and I'm really enjoying it, and therefore I'm building a brand new website just for that, and I'm building it with Squarespace. You don't need to know code or need to be a web design expert or whatever. It's pretty easy to use and it makes things look beautiful. If any of you guys want to create your own website, whether to showcase your photos from plane spotting or a blog or whatever it is, go to squarespace.com/CaptainJoe to get a free trial and 10% off for your first purchase.